good afternoon to in-house counsel and in-house legal professionals from all across North America and the world. Welcome to In-House Connect. My name is Shai Mahani. I'm the CEO and co-founder of In-House Connect, and I'm thrilled to have you on with us today. Thank you for spending your breakfast time or your lunchtime or your dinner time. And special thanks to our wonderful sponsor, SimpleDocs, and our fantastic presenters today, Preston Clark and Electra Japonas, who are going to teach us how to automate your NDA process, a guide for in-house counsel. This is our 50th event of the year, which is crazy. Woo-hoo! Please let us know if you've tuned in for the first time at your first IHC webinar. Let's get to today's event, how to automate your NDA process, a guide for in-house counsel. We are joined by two of the brightest minds in NDA and NDA education, starting with Electra Japonas. Electra is the founder and CEO of TLB, a legal optimization company that works with legal teams to streamline the way they work with best-in-class legal operations and technology support. Electra is also the co-founder of oneNDA, an open-source initiative to standardize the NDA template globally. With a deep passion for legal innovation, Electra's vision is to empower organizations of all sizes with smarter, more effective approaches to the way their legal teams work. Before establishing TLB, Electra honed her skills and knowledge over a decade in prominent organizations, including the European Space Agency, Disney, BAT, and EY, where she played pivotal roles in commercial legal and data protection. And joined by Electra is Preston Clark. Preston is a three-time founder and former in-house attorney. He's currently the CEO of SimpleDocs, a contract automation platform that launched in 2023. And Preston is also the co-founder of Law Insider, the popular clause database used by millions of lawyers and business leaders around the world. We have a wonderful panel. And without further ado, I'll turn things over to Preston to get us started.
Thank you, Shai. I just want to thank you. I know you and I have been talking for years seemingly about doing a webinar event, and here we are doing it. And I appreciate how much effort it goes into pulling these off as I'm looking at these poll results. Electra, 17% of our attendees here today are our first timers. So we're gonna leave a very good impression on this audience. And so let's jump right into it. How to automate your NDA process. I'm going to have Electra do a bit of a longer introduction because her history and her background is so important, not only to the work that she's done and why the work she does is so important, but how it relates to NDA automation. And so we're going to talk about standards. We're going to talk about oneNDA.org and what it means to put forth a standard like that and how it enables organizations, perhaps like yours, to think differently about your automation process. Let me jump into Electra. We're going to do some polls. I'm going to talk about the agenda, but I just want to start with you because I think your background, as I mentioned, is so, so important to the topic that we're talking about today. So can you just take a couple of minutes to walk us through a little bit about the background and its relevance to NDAs?
Sure. Firstly, thank you for having me, and it's great to be here. So the background to oneNDA has quite a long history. I started off my career in the space industry, and the space industry it's just steeped in standards because that's how engineers work. And so the industry reflects that. So when I entered into this industry, I found that, and this is kind of how I grew up, if you like, as a lawyer, because my first role was at the European Space Agency, I grew up with the understanding that two parties would enter into a negotiation or a partnership on the basis of a standard agreement, because that's really what the European Space Agency does. It issues a template agreement, and the whole of the space industry within Europe works off this standard agreement. And then I went into the commercial world, and I found that that was very different, and that each party had their own version of an agreement. But ultimately, that agreement basically said the same thing as the next agreement, but expressed in different words. And that lack of standardization across the board always frustrated me. And if you look at it in software terms, there's a lack of interoperability, because if you have an agreement that says the same things as the next agreement, but expressed differently, then when you send it to the other side and it lands on their desk, they're going to have to check whether that agreement fits with their view of what's acceptable. So this creates a lot of friction and inefficiency and frustration between parties. So after years of working in-house as the conduit between legal and business in more of a contract manager or legal manager role, I founded TLB, and the idea with TLB was always to streamline the way that legal operates so that there'd be more job satisfaction for legal, because often you find that there is a disconnect between the business and legal, but also because I thought that legal could add so much more value if the two sides spoke more of the same language. So I started off TLB, and the idea was to offer this legal operations consultancy. But then COVID hit, and during COVID, I found that people wanted less of the legal ops consultancy and more of just a spare pair of hands to help with contract review and the heavy lifting. So I grew the business in that part, in that direction during that time. And so we were reviewing people's contracts for them, because that's really what our clients needed. And at the end of COVID, at the end of the first year of COVID, we did a review of all the contracts that we'd looked at. And we found that 63% of all agreements we'd reviewed were NDAs, but that only accounted for 7% of our revenue, which is an absolutely ridiculous stat and totally flies in the face of what it is that we were trying to achieve in the first place with a business that is there to optimize legal. If anything, NDAs do the complete opposite of optimizing legal. They create friction in relationships. They put barriers between parties. They're not conducive to the healthy relationships that we're trying to build with an ultimate commercial relationship that we enter into. So I put a thought out on LinkedIn, which was, why are we doing this? Why are we just signing volumes and volumes of these low value, high friction, low ROI agreements? Why are we doing this? Is this the definition of madness? And it got huge visibility and support from across the legal community. I had lots of people messaging me saying, I agree. And then I put another thought on LinkedIn, which was, why don't we just agree to one NDA template? So taking inspiration from my years in the space industry, why don't we just have a standard NDA template that we all enter into? And again, the response was phenomenal. So I decided to spearhead an initiative to standardize the NDA, and one NDA came into existence. Sorry, Preston, I'll pause there because I realize I've been talking for a very long time.
That's exactly what I was hoping the story and the context you would give. And so today, as we dive into these topics of NDA standardization, NDA automation, which is the title of the event, you're going to hear us reference standardization, and we're not here to espouse the oneNDA.org standard, although it's free and you should go check it out, but we are here to espouse the framework and the ideology around creating standards and adopting standards as a part of your approach. And you may decide not to do it, but even at the very least, looking at how standards are structured and function is a good way to influence your own template design should you decide to do that. So, Electra, that was a wonderful introduction. Mine will be much shorter. Shai already gave it, but I think it's important for you all to know that I wake up every day thinking specifically about NDA standardization and automation, as ridiculous as that may sound. And so the lens through which both Electra and I are coming to this, Electra and I are partners. We speak on a daily basis, and the sole thing that we speak about is how to better standardize and better automate the non-disclosure agreement. So I promise that if you care about that topic, you've come to the right place, and we'll make very good use of your time today. The agenda is, we're going to talk about standardization and oneNDA. Electra has already started down that path with her introduction. We're talking about creating balanced NDAs and standards, whether that's using one that exists or creating your own. We're going to talk about NDA negotiations. Electra has lots of experience there in terms of how you approach it and how you hope the other side will approach it. And then I'm going to talk about automation frameworks and measuring success. And the idea being that irrespective of whether you use your own tools or third-party tools or a combination of tools, there's some really easy lessons and frameworks for building out an automation process, because it's one thing to adopt a standard or to develop a really balanced mutual non-disclosure agreement, and something else to have that routed quickly through your business out to the counterparty, back, signature, repository, all of those pieces which matter a great deal. So we're going to be talking about that today. But to start, we want to know about you. Presumably, if you are spending this much time with us today, maybe it's because it seems like a tolerable topic and you get some CLE credits, or maybe it's because NDAs are an actual very painful part of your life and existence, in which case, Electra and I want to know that because that helps shape and understand how we present today. And it also is very interesting to us to understand how much pain is in fact out there. So this first question is, how many NDAs on average is your business signing per year? So I see a range of 10 to 50, 50 to 100, 100 to 500, 500 plus. In my experience, and I think Electra will echo this, you know, below 100, you can probably endure it with the most broken, dysfunctional process in the world, which may be the one that you have. And when you start getting north of 100, it becomes something that really needs to be operationalized. Now, you may be sitting here at 78 per year saying, no, Preston, it is plenty painful for us to find a better way. And we'll talk about that today. But I think as a sort of line in the sand for Electra and I, we're always looking for organizations that are sort of 100 and above, because we know at that point, they sort of raise their hand and say, there has to be a better way to do this. And we're willing to actually do the work to figure out how to get there. Okay, so the largest group is 30% at 100 to 500. So Electra, we have some of our people here. All of you are our people, to be clear. But I think we have a meaningful percentage, 50 to 100 and 100 to 500 make up 63%, 62% of the group. So the 500 plus, we really care about you. I'd be very curious to hear what you're doing, because you certainly are doing something at that threshold or at that volume. And 10 to 50, hopefully you'll be able to take away some things from this today as well. So the second poll, 50% of you have indicated that the NDAs are signed on your own or your first party paper. And that's 60% now. That is outstanding, because that's where the opportunity is. If it's all counterparty or third party paper, that's a different workflow. Now we are talking about redlining tools and AI enabled tools and mechanisms to streamline something that, you know, unfortunately is probably a painful process for your legal team. But when it's your paper, there's more opportunity for standardization. And there's more opportunity for automation. So that's outstanding. Electra, the third question, what are your biggest pain points currently with your NDA process? This is multi-select, too many NDA requests to manage, or no self-serve access. That's 32%. Second up is at 38%, too many third-party NDAs to manage. Okay. So, you know, that's sort of, you know, not most of you are sending your own predominantly, but the third party ones that are coming in are probably a disproportionate amount of the pain. Electra and her team managed that pain for many years at TLB. No alerts for expiring NDAs, 28%. No visibility into signed NDAs, 22%. And so that's great. Electra, any insights or perspectives as you're seeing these?
I mean, this is great and really valuable to see who we're talking to today. I think the fact that the biggest problem that people are facing is that there's too many third party NDAs to manage. Yet 60% of the audience says that more than half of their NDAs are on their own paper. Just shows how painful third party NDAs are.
Right. Even if it's a smaller percentage of the total overall NDAs that are being managed. Yep.
Yeah.
So Shai, we can close this out, but we definitely have the right audience here, and let's jump into the material. So Electra, to start, want to talk about the oneNDA global standard and some of the origin story you've already given us. But I think the idea here is to talk about what it means to build a standard. And again, this is not about oneNDA specifically as much as there's wonderful, I think next week, Todd from Bond Terms is presenting, he has a standard. There's plenty of standards out there, but the idea of building a standard and how it is created, I think is central to why it is effective. Because what we were trying to do is reduce red lines and accelerate negotiations or reduce negotiations or eliminate negotiations. And so much of the building of a standard is what influences and what accelerates the speed. So if you talk to us a little bit about what it means to have a standard through the story of oneNDA, I think it would be great.
Sure. I think I'll start at the end with this. So the end, the situation that we're in today is that we have over 3,500 companies that have adopted oneNDA. And today I got a message from someone saying that their counterpart, so the adopter who messaged me, said that they'd sent one NDA to the other side, and the other side wasn't an adopter, but they were aware of one NDA and they agree it all the time, were the words of the other side. So the leverage that we're giving people with a global standard that's recognized across the world is the fact that it's not their branding, it's not their NDA, it's not first party paper, it's neutral paper, right? That is leverage that people are using and benefiting from. And to get to that stage, there's a lot of work that goes into it. So I thought about the standard NDA and how to create it long and hard, obviously, before I started it. And I came to the conclusion, having really delved into some other initiatives that try to standardize simple forms like the NDA. And my conclusion was that the reason that those standards weren't that successful is because there was a lack of buy-in at the outset. And so my idea was that we would create buy-in by getting people to input into the creation process and to build in public, and to be very transparent about the challenges that we're facing in trying to achieve something that's quite ambitious, such as this. So the way I started it, just to give you the overall story of how we went about it so that you can understand the level of work that goes into it, was that I started off by putting this thought onto LinkedIn. As I said, I got lots of responses from various people. And so I said, okay, I'm going to start a website on Squarespace. I'm going to do it over a weekend. And if I can get 100 people to sign up, 100 lawyers specifically, to sign up to say that they will support the initiative, if we go ahead with it, then I'll spearhead it. And I said I'd give people 2 weeks to do it, to gauge interest. And we hit that number 12 hours from launch. And so that was evidence to me that this had really struck a chord. I think the NDA is also quite particular in that case, because everyone dislikes them and there isn't much ROI to them. So we hit that number in 12 hours from launch. And then over the next 2 weeks, we had over 330 organizations that had signed up to be part of this initiative. And so what I did is I created a subgroup from these people that had signed up, and I called it a steering committee. And the steering committee comprised of two types of lawyers. We had in-house counsel and we had law firm lawyers, private practice lawyers, from quite prominent law firms. And the reason I did this was because I wanted the in-house lawyers to test the stuff that we were building from their own perspective. And I wanted the law firms to give the project credence, really, and to demonstrate to the world that this is actually a high quality document. And together with the steering committee, we co-created one NDA. We got together, we pulled an agreement that was given to us by the World Commerce and Contracting. We broke it down into the functions that NDA was delivering on. And then the steering committee agreed which of those functions would go in and out. And then the law firms, who were called the drafting committee, went away and drafted the wording that would express those functions, if you like. And then the in-house lawyers voted on the best wording, because each law firm did their own version of the wording. The in-house lawyers then decided which wording they liked. And then we created one NDA version zero. We then put that version out to the world and we got input from the broader community. At this stage, the community was up to 1,200 lawyers. So one NDA is officially the most expensive NDA ever drafted. We got the input from the 1,200 lawyers. We iterated, we learned a lot from that process. And then we put it back to the steering committee, who rubber stamped it, and then we put it out as version one. And then once the document was in use for 6 months, we released it, and then we gathered feedback from the broader community that was using it. And then 6 months down the line, we released version two, which picked up lots of the snags. And we're about to repeat that process, so stay tuned.
Yeah, and for those wondering about what it means to adopt a standard and how much influence it has, invariably what the counterparty wants to know, as Electra's story indicates, is who else adopts this, and what was the rigor that went into its development. And that's a high bar, right? And it has to be an independent third party. Very difficult for a software company or a for-profit entity to say, hey, this is the standard, everyone should use it, and by the way, we own it. And so the oneNDA.org, I think, is a really good model. And as I mentioned, there are others out there that have followed a similar structure. But what ends up happening is exactly what Electra just indicated, which is that there's a ricochet effect where organizations start to get familiar with the oneNDA standard, even if they themselves have not adopted it, and they know what it entails, and they know the other organizations that have adopted it and that use it. And this contributes now to the acceleration in getting it signed without redlining, which is the ultimate goal, speed to signature. Okay, Electra, let's back up now, or maybe move forward. I'm not sure which direction we're going in, but we're talking now about the problem statement that NDA automation and NDA standardization is trying to solve for. So walk us through this.
Yeah, so 65% of time, in-house legal's time, can be spent on low value, high volume work, right? And that, of course, takes you away from the more strategic work. Now, when you join an in-house team, or when you start off as a sole counsel in an organization, you're probably doing it because you want to add strategic value to that organization and have a very commercial type of input in that. And unfortunately, lots of lawyers are unable to do that because they spend loads of their time just firefighting on low value, high volume, urgent contracts that leave little time for the more strategic things that they actually want to be working on. And the lack of automation, of course, contributes to this. So it's not good for anyone. It's not good for the business that hired you. It's not good for you. And legal teams are chronically under-resourced because they're quite a precious team. They're quite a highly paid team. And this ratio of 1 to 100 employees is actually quite an optimistic ratio. And I see this, the larger the organization, the less legal resource there is in that organization. So legal is always going to be one of the most stretched teams in any team, in any business. And there's so much that's expected of legal. It's just not fair on them, and also not fair on the business that they spend loads of their time doing the more lower value work.
Yeah, and when we think about that, and we think about the polls that we did a few minutes ago, and that there's a high percentage of NDA volume, you know, in the hundreds for the majority, 60% of attendees have 100 or more that are going out in a year or being signed in a year, and you understand that, you know, many of those are being negotiated, and that's causing a lot of pain. You know, this idea of, you know, I didn't go to law school to negotiate NDAs or to manage them, nor did Electra, nor did most of you, or perhaps any of you. And so the cumulative impact, however, of doing these in-house or of spending your time on it in an inefficient way is taking you away, right? It's taking you away from the work that you endeavor to do. And that's a big problem. So I think these stats are significant. And I think that they align with why all of you are on this webinar today, because you're dealing with high volume and you would much rather be doing something else. Okay, but one approach to this, of course, is how about we don't automate Electra and we don't standardize? We just what? I guess we could outsource, or we could, you know, go ask for budget to bring this in-house.
Sure. And I think that's the most obvious solution, isn't it? I've got loads of work. What do? Get more people in to do the work. But that's not scalable. And it also creates other problems as well along the way. So having more people in your team means more management. That's more overhead. That's again taking you away from the more strategic work that you want to be doing, particularly if you're managing people that are predominantly doing routine work, because they're the people that are the hardest to motivate, to be completely blunt. They are, because to Preston's point earlier, no one studied law to just manage NDAs or routine contracts. As a cost center, you'll never be able to hire enough people to keep pace with business growth, because you just won't get the budget. And then this is an interesting stat, but 70% of lawyers plan on leaving their jobs in the next year due to unmotivating workloads. And this was from a recent piece of research that happened last year. But effectively, people being given more and more work because the operational model of a legal team isn't being thought through doesn't work in the long term.
Yeah. And, you know, it's such the NDA is so unique in this way, because we know the stories for big law firms perhaps you're giving it to your most junior associates, you're not billing for those hours, you're using it as a training mechanism, maybe you're outsourcing it to a firm like an Entra or something else where they're absorbing a bunch of the work. It's remarkable to me. I love it. This is such an interesting and fascinating topic to me because it's this sort of mini industry unto itself, because the non-disclosure agreement is so unique in this regard. Because I don't think, and you know, Electra, you may challenge this, maybe DPAs, we feel the same way, but I think the NDA is largely unique in how ambivalent we are about it, how high volume it is, and how much pain it causes us, and yet how much we endure just, you know, sort of despite ourselves, because we don't want to deal with it. We are ambivalent about it. It is low risk, but nevertheless, it dominates a lot of our hours. And that last stat at the bottom, 70% of lawyers plan on leaving. I love the concept of unmotivating workloads. NDAs are squarely in that category.
Sure.
So let's talk about the role of in-house to enable the business to achieve its objectives. So now we're really going to put some burden on all of you and say, not that it's your fault, but it's your responsibility to pull yourself out of this, because no one's going to come riding in to solve this for you. So Electra, let's talk about what this means for in-house teams.
I think this is often a mindset shift for lawyers, particularly when you've gone from private practice into an in-house environment. This is because when you're in private practice, you're encouraged to bill lots of hours, and you're there to mitigate risk for your client. You're there to call out all the risks. And then you go in-house, and people don't really want to know all of that in minute detail. What they want to know is whether they can go ahead with something or not. How are you going to help them enable it? How are you going to enable them to achieve their objectives? And I think that the minute we understand that our role as in-house lawyers is to enable the business to achieve its objectives rather than call out the risks, that's still your job, but it's not your predominant role. You're there to help the business do what it needs to do. Because if you're just calling out risks and you're not helping the business to grow, then without a business, there's no point in you calling out risks. So it's important to understand that that's the role. Once you appreciate that to the full extent, then you'll really understand that automation and scalability and building a team that can do that at pace is paramount.
So let's talk about what we get from balanced drafting. So, you know, let me just frame this by saying, when we talk about standards, we think of, or when we talk about balanced, I should say, standards is sort of the pinnacle, at least in my view, because it means that it is not only drafted by, in this case, as Electra mentioned, steering committee that took it very seriously over months and months and months, but that is just a version of a balanced agreement. So you don't need to adopt a standard in order to get to balance. So talk about what it means to adopt or implement or draft in a balanced way.
Yeah, drafting in a balanced way is key, right? And when we did one NDA, we made sure that we took a very balanced approach to the provisions that we included. There are people asking, I saw in the chat, there are people asking about specific parts of the agreement. If you go to the website, there's actually a graveyard where we put all the clauses that didn't make the cut into one NDA and our rationale as to why they didn't make the cut. So for trade secrets, specifically, there's a rationale there as to why that wasn't included in one NDA. And the reason we did this and the reason we paid so much attention to balanced drafting is because often as lawyers, we think that our job is to win points. So we'll go in with a contract that's very one-sided with a view to win as many points as possible. But actually in your head or on paper, if you're organized, you've got a playbook. And that playbook says that if that doesn't get accepted by the other side, then this is my acceptable fallback position. And some people might have two or three fallback positions. And what I've always said is, if you want speed to contract, just be more amenable with your preferred position and present the first one that you're ready to accept. Like, what's your least best position? If you're ready to accept that and you're happy to forego some of the risk annihilation that you're trying to achieve for the benefit of speed to contracts, then do it. And so adopting a standard will give you this immediately, because those people have thought about it and they want to make sure that it's as adoptable as possible. But if you haven't, then think about this when you're drafting your own contracts as well.
Yeah. And to illustrate a point, in a few minutes, I will show you what it looks like, the actual structure of Electra's oneNDA template. You can go, and if Shai or someone on Shai's team wants to type this into chat, oneNDA.org, you can download the document and see it in living color as it exists today, as well as the graveyard, as Electra mentioned. But an illustration of what Electra just said that often gets productized, which I think is really innovative, but also is really scary, and it illustrates the point she made, is the idea that when you send out an NDA to be created or generated or reviewed, you actually prompt the counterparty to select among confidentiality period options or jurisdiction options upfront, because you are revealing to them all of your fallback positions, which normally we hide inside a playbook spreadsheet somewhere. But in this case, we're literally saying, take your choice. And I think for some attorneys, rightfully so, this goes against the very nature of negotiation that has been in sort of ingrained in our brain, which is that this is a back and forth process. But again, because of the volume, the routine nature of the non-disclosure agreement, the philosophical shift of saying, actually, I'm going to present this to you and say, what would you like it to be? Here's what we feel comfortable with, and letting them select in the spirit of speed and efficiency. And I do think, again, that that's unique to the non-disclosure agreement. I think other agreement types can support that. Folks in the comment would love to get your reaction if that's something you've either tried before or contemplated, or if it's something that you have allergic reaction to because you're saying, no, Preston, we would never do that because, you know, California is our jurisdiction and we're not going to put, or New York, because we know that 50% of the time they're going to select that, when only 20% of the time we would have accepted that in actual negotiation. And so the trade-off now is you're going to go get 30% more of jurisdiction wins for 100% more of the labor that goes into the process of actually negotiating that through. So we'll show you what that looks like in a second, but So let's talk about standardization and sort of what it means in the flow of the process of automation.
Yeah, I think what makes a contract right for standardization, because not all contracts are good for complete standardization. If you're selling a widget that's highly bespoke with lots of IP, you probably shouldn't go ahead and standardize that, because it's always going to be negotiated. So it's good to still have a balanced agreement, but not necessarily a standard agreement. So high volume is key, and then standard common terms, which is why an NDA is perfect for standardization. We've also standardized the DPA and one NDA that's specific for M&A scenarios or private markets. But effectively, anything that's high volume and quite standard, one of those that you're reviewing, you think, God, I reviewed one that said exactly the same thing yesterday, but it was slightly different, then this would be good for standardization.
And so I'm sure this question is coming in, or people are thinking about it. And I'll show you what this looks like in a minute. But Electra, will you just describe how to say a standard? Well, you know, if this thing is fixed and locked, where does jurisdiction go? Where does the confidentiality period go? How do you reconcile the notion of a locked standard with the fact that every NDA has to be unique in some way?
For sure, yeah. I mean, every agreement will have variables and things that are going to be negotiated to suit each specific scenario. But what you want to do is encourage the right behaviors. So when you send someone a document where those variables are embedded in the document, you're almost inviting a red line. So what you want is efficiency. You've taken a very pragmatic approach to NDAs. You realize that they hardly ever get litigated, and you realize that you want speed here. So what you really want to do, this goes for any agreement, but NDAs in particular, what you want to do is collect all the things that you're happy to negotiate and put them at the top of the agreement. This will do two things. Firstly, it will make it really easy for you to automate, because most tech tools want that to be the case. They want you to be able to kind of collate all the stuff that's going to become a form in one place. But secondly, you're creating a user experience for the other side who's going to be receiving that document that tells them, look, this is the stuff that I'm happy to negotiate, but this stuff here is boilerplate, don't touch it. So the structure of the document when you're creating it is key to the way that you then go on to automate it.
Yeah. And the objection, and sort of another topic that we maybe touch on for 1 minute, is that, well, Electra just said, don't touch it, is probably the biggest impediment to standard adoption, because we all as lawyers intellectualize the edge cases, or maybe more than the edge cases, which is the attorney, the receiving party, who's looking at this as third party paper, irrespective of the fact that it's a standard, and says, listen, this is not how I negotiate. This is not like I have been trained with a red pen, you know, from my cold dead hand, will this red pen be removed? And they need to do the thing that they've been trained to do. And so the result is, you say, well, because this will invariably get negotiated anyway, you know, what is the purpose of a standard? And what I would say is, we get back to like, what percentage of the time is it counterparty paper versus first party paper? What percentage of your NDAs are getting negotiated at all? I should have asked that in the polls and I didn't. The understanding is that if 50% of the time your NDA is being negotiated, or 30% of the time it's being negotiated, what we are trying to do, what we are advocating for, is for you to get that to 70% or 80%. We know it's not going to get to 100%, but that those meaningful percentage point jumps are going to save an incredible amount of time and speed, so that, you know, the remaining 20 or 30% that are left over can still be dealt with in an efficient way. And there's AI tools and others that can accelerate that part. But I do think it's, talk about an allergic reaction. I think that for many of us, it's scary to think about adopting something that we know is not going to be a silver bullet in terms of fixing the problem.
But there is no silver bullet, right? I mean, I saw a question in the chat. Has oneNDA been tested in terms of its forcibility in courts? It hasn't, to my knowledge, but nor has yours. So we adopt our own standard NDAs that have been hodgepodged from various other templates potentially. And we're not concerned so much about that, but we're concerned more when we adopt a standard, as we should be, because we don't want to adopt anything that's low quality. But we need to take a pragmatic approach when it comes to things like NDAs, because the research shows that they hardly ever get litigated. So is it proportionate? If your objective as a lawyer is to be an enabler of the business, is the time and money that you spend on NDAs proportionate to the value that you get from them? And I think that's really what the question is.
Yeah, and that's a good comment in the chat, and I'm sure that other people are head nodding, being like, "No, what is this?" Like,
for sure.
And I think, you know, but I think Electra's rebuttal is fair, right? And you say, "No, ours has been litigated." Okay, sure, but the majority have not, and so what we're looking for is sort of the 80-20 rule on this, which is, this is a better approach in most cases because it's going to reduce the time we spend managing this process. Is the goal of standardization to eliminate red lines or reduce red lines? This is very sort of thematic here. This is a question that when I first met Electra, I asked her, and I think that the answer is, well, we've spoken to it, but let's hang here for a minute, because it relates to what it means to enable the negotiations on the variable side rather than in the core of the document.
I mean, lawyers love a red pen, and we're always going to get it out when we see something we don't like in a contract. The idea of having a standard form was to stop people from redlining things that don't really matter, because we've all agreed there's consensus in the market that that's standard, right? Some people might want to have a penalty clause in their NDAs, but the majority of receivers who look at an NDA that says that will get their red pen out when there is a penalty clause, because in my opinion, and in many others' opinion, there's no room for a penalty clause in an NDA. That's not the purpose of the agreement, to penalize the other side if, you know, things don't go a certain way. There might be very few instances in which that is appropriate, and I completely accept that. But oneNDA in particular exists to satisfy 80 to 90% of the instances in which you need an NDA. And that's not every single instance. If you're Coca-Cola and you're sharing your secret sauce, you shouldn't use oneNDA. So we're not unrealistic. We know that we're never going to eliminate red lines, but definitely to reduce as much as possible and get to the point where we've got a market standard that's acceptable to most.
We're about 35, 38 minutes in. If you were saying enough, no more one NDA, no more standardization, I'm here to learn about automation. We're going to talk about that now. But I can't help myself but to say, if you're not going to adopt a standard, you need to have a balanced, well-drafted template. And who am I to say yours is or is not? But you know, there's companies like Term Scout and others that will measure yours for balance. But if it's not balanced, don't automate it because it's not going to work. And so our emphasis on standardization and our emphasis on balance is just to sort of say, without that, you don't get to go to the next step in the game. You don't get to think about operationalizing something that at its core is craving inefficiency or is attracting inefficiency. So Electra, let's just take a couple of minutes here. And then I wanted to dive into automation frameworks that, irrespective of what template you use, or whether it's yours drafted by your law firm or a standard, you can implement within your organization. But Electra, you have a ton of experience in this because you have worked with organizations that have not only standardized, but have also automated. And I want to start, this is sort of like a pre-mortem, like if it fails, this is why. So after this, we're going to talk about frameworks, but let's take a minute here to talk about why automations fail when they do.
Sure. Yeah. So the first is unrealistic expectations. I think people think that automating their NDA will be easy and quick and it will happen overnight. And often, you know, that can be the case. But often things like, is your template up to scratch? Have you managed the right stakeholders? Do you understand what your existing workflow is so that you can then automate it? Are things that people aren't necessarily prepared for. So they think they're just going to buy something, it's going to be immediately plug and play, and it's not. So they have an unrealistic expectation there that's not met. The second is poor planning. So that goes for anything in life, really. But if you're not planning for the change to your process, you don't know what the right day is. You know, you're planning it. You're planning to drop this new process on a holiday or in August when everyone's away. That's not going to work. So you do need to plan what you're going to do and make sure that you're prepared for it. And the other people that you need to bring into the process are also prepared. The third is bad contracts. Often people blame the tech when actually the problem is the contract. If you've got a highly convoluted, bad NDA that's 10 pages long, full of variables, it's going to be very difficult to automate. So you want to ensure that you're spending your time fixing your contract before you then go and digitize it. Because the worst thing about this is that if you digitize a bad contract, you're actually perpetuating the problem that contract might be creating. The fourth is no buy-in. So sometimes someone in a team might think, right, this is such a ripe use case, automating NDAs, but then they don't get the necessary level of buy-in from other teams or even people within their teams, like might have an IT or the general counsel that you need to get on board to make this happen. So make sure that you're speaking to the right people and presenting your business case to them in a way that they're interested in. The next is lack of understanding of requirements. So often you don't quite understand why you're automating it, who's going to be using the form. When we were doing one NDA, we found that 75% of NDA drafters were not legal, it was the business. So it's really important that you understand your requirement and who it is that you're going to give this to, because then you might need to understand their requirements before you implement a successful document automation. Overlooking process complexity. Again, people might think that it's just as simple as sending out a link when it might not be. It depends, of course, on the tech that you're using. But yeah, understanding what your current process is and how you're going to simplify it with tech is key. Wrong tech. People sometimes buy enormous CLMs. I've seen it time and time again, just to implement an NDA automation and hope that they might be able to reap the benefits from the broader solution later on. That doesn't work. If today you need something small and robust to do something really, really well, go for that. And then as you grow, then maybe look at something different, but don't just buy the wrong solution. Insufficient resources. So with NDAs, this shouldn't be a huge problem because it's quite a straightforward use case. But make sure you've got people on board who are going to help you deliver the implementation and the automation, particularly from a comms aspect. Because if you're now going to change the way that sales works, you need to be telling them the right things at the right time. Going too big too soon, so trying to automate 10 forms at the same time or your whole template suite isn't going to work. And NDA automation is a great POC. It's a great way for you to learn how this works more broadly and what's successful and what's not. And then thinking it's one and done. So once you've implemented your NDA automation, just make sure that you're getting feedback from the rest of the business. Legal, how is this working? Are the questions that you're asking them understandable to them, for example? Make sure that you're iterating and making the process better and better. So those are my 10 reasons.
This has been a really good setup, right? So we've set up the idea of automation. We've talked about standardization, balance terms. We've talked about sort of a pre-mortem on when automations fail, why they fail. And so now let's talk about the automation framework. And this is where I get to grab the mic for a minute and say, I wake up every morning building tools and helping organizations automate the non-disclosure agreement process. And so what's the best CLM for automating the NDA process? And the wrong question. So this is not what we're talking about. We're not talking about vendor selection or what tool you should use. We're actually talking about something else entirely. It's not about CLM. In fact, you shouldn't start there at all. You should not start with the tool. You should start with the framework. And so we're talking about your NDA process. The reason not to do CLM, and I want to hang here for 1 second because it's an important point of view that we have, because most of us default. We go from standardization, or we go from a template we love that needs to be automated to, therefore, we need a CLM. And the reason CLMs are too big for NDA automation is it's too much software. You're not ready for it. And it's really time. It takes a long time to get initial value. And so what that means is that when you buy something that has 47 doors in it and it takes 2 months to implement, your whole NDA automation should not take 2 months to implement. And so buying something that is overdone and too big and too complex is going to make it very, very difficult for you to actually achieve the goals that Alexa just outlined. The concept of readiness comes up a lot, that you may not, in fact, have everything in place in order to derive value from a CLM. And then the worst scenario, and if you've read the sort of Gartner report that says, I think 50% of CLMs implementations in 2024 will fail to deliver the expected value or some wording like that. It's because it just takes a long time to start getting the wins that you need. And for legal and in-house in particular, we are not accustomed to, trained for buying software. If you're a CRO or a VP of marketing, you know, you see, even a CFO, you are buying software all the time, your entire career. It's the central. The first thing you do when you get hired on is you go rip out the old software and you bring in the new software. And in legal, we may be a part of the software acquisition process. We might be embedded in procurement, but we're not typically advocating for budget, which creates a lot of risk, which means that don't overdo this. Go get a win. Go get a quick win. This slide may seem out of context, but enterprise software is very, very complex because it takes a long time to implement. And when you're talking about automating something like a non-disclosure agreement, you want to anchor on the things that are at the bottom. What is the fast win? And there's nothing faster than the non-disclosure agreement. So now it really matters how you do that, how you achieve it. What are the tools you use? So we get into the framework, and the framework starts with the goal. So now we're finally getting into automation frameworks. The goal for outbound NDA automation, your paper, no red lines, our e-sign. Our paper, no red lines, our e-sign. It seems simple, but this is what you need to have happen. Because every one of these, any one of these that has a red X instead of the black check mark is going to dramatically decrease your efficiency. And you can't always control your paper, but I bet you can get more of your paper signed more often than you are today through speed, through the user experience on the counterparty side. You don't want any red lines. That's nice to say. How do we do that? Electra's been talking about it. Some of it is in the balance drafting. Maybe it's in a draft in adopting a standard, but it's also in allowing, as I mentioned, the counterparty to very easily select things like jurisdiction or modify purpose or change confidentiality period in a way that is tolerable to us, that doesn't introduce a redlining step into the process. And so finding ways to eliminate redlining by enabling the types of actions that get us to signature faster without taking the red pen out. And then our e-sign is really important too. It may seem non-obvious, but you know, I talk to a lot of investment bankers and private equity and others who are managing all of their NDA process through their inbox. And it's incredible how much tolerance they have for just being like, oh, I'm not sure. They'll sign it and then they're going to send it back. And it's like, okay, so you signed them a clean Word document and what then they're converting to PDF and then they're maybe routing it e-sign internally. It's like, why did you just add 3 days to your process? And so your e-sign means your control, and it also means your repository. So all of these things interconnect. So when you think about what your goals is, your paper, no red lines, and your e-sign. Template design, we started with already. Template configuration means that you are populating the parts of your template in a very fixed way that ensure compliance internally so that your business teams, your sales teams, your corp dev teams don't have the control to just go grab a Word document somewhere and put in whatever they want in the pursuit of expedience, that they have access to it, that it shows up in your tools, in your systems, in Salesforce, in HubSpot, in Slack, in Teams, wherever it is, that is incredibly accessible. This is maybe the most important part of automation, is accessibility to your business teams. We think about like CLM or other legal tools. We think of these as legal tools. Well, guess what? Your sales team does not want to adopt a legal tool. They want to use a business tool, which means that your legal tools need to show up as business tools. Your legal tools need to show up as business tools, which means they need to be integrated into the tools you're already using. The counterparty experience can't require the counterparty to change their behavior. Maybe you can do it a little bit in the margins, but DocuSign has already been spending 20 years getting behavior change. They've done the bulk of the work for us. We just need them to sign electronically. Short of that, we wanted to make it really, really easy for them to work through the experience, for them to learn what oneNDA is, for them to download the document, for them to sign on the spot, whatever it may be. But the counterparty experience has to be very lightweight and has to mirror how they're used to operating already. Common negotiations, we've been talking about it. It's enabling the structure whereby the counterparty can propose changes in a structure that you've already accepted so that we don't unnecessarily get stuck in red line land. I think that this is unique to non-disclosure agreements, or at least it is more common in non-disclosure agreements. And of course, e-sign and storage has to be a part of the framework as well, because in many cases, the way things like DocuSign and others are structured is that everyone in your organization has their own e-sign tool. They're sending out the non-disclosure agreement. You don't really know about it other than, you know, maybe you sort of heard rumblings in Slack somewhere that an NDA was going out. And then once it is signed, where does it end up? It ends up back in their DocuSign folder, and you don't actually have visibility and you can't find the document. And you certainly don't know when the confidentiality period runs out. So these are sort of the holistic framework of what goes into automating the non-disclosure agreement process. These are a little bit agnostic because I think it also ties into other automations that are MSA and other things. So I'm going to take maybe three more minutes just to show you what this looks like in action, or at least speak to it. So is the goal to reduce negotiations or streamline negotiations? The goal is to streamline. Is your agreement balanced? Is it well-structured? Is it well-structured for negotiation? So that's number one. Number two, template configuration. What you see on the screen right here is an example of what it looks like. Platform agnostic. You can do this with just about any software tool that you may have that is a workflow tool. It's bringing the oneNDA standard and the oneNDA variables or your own variable structure into a workflow where things like purpose and confidentiality period and country and governing law can be preset by you and enabled for the counterparty to modify on their own. Right. And again, this is this controversial perhaps idea of saying, I'm going to invite you to change confidentiality period. I'm going to invite you to change governing law because we are relatively agnostic on these, or at least to a degree, and because I don't want you to download this document and start redlining it. So template configuration matters a great deal. I think even if you don't use something like oneNDA, you should go look and download oneNDA and see how they do it and consider implementing that into your own template. I'll say that again. Even if you have no interest in ever adopting a standard, go look at how a standard template, an NDA template, is designed and give it some thought, because it is designed to invite change in a way that is going to shorten your time to signature? Accessibility, can my business teams access routine templates without asking legal? Can counterparties initiate the process? Are the templates easy to complete? Is it clear how templates should be shared with counterparties? All of these are really the productization that allows the business to consume a template, allows them to quickly create, allows them to quickly send, even in some cases allows the counterparty to initiate the process themselves. So template access is super, super important. Counterparty experience, we've talked about. In this visual here, you see oneNDA. This is actually the old badge, but you see oneNDA as a brand being put forth, reminding them that this is something that is balanced. As Electra said, this is not third-party paper or counterparty paper. This is neutral paper. How you communicate that is really, really important. And then common negotiations, and this is the part that I think we've been talking a lot about already, but it's actually bringing both parties into an experience where they can expediently get to agreement on the parts that are commonly negotiated. Now, you may disagree in your use case what these variables should be. Maybe for you, it's just duration in governing law, because you're like, these are the things that always get negotiated. But I encourage you to invite the counterparties to start this process and to make these changes proactively. And then what ends up happening, and this is one way to visualize it, is that someone on your team would be notified. And all you would do is approve and send. And in this case, and it's so wonderful now that we think about it as a pre-negotiation process or an accelerated negotiation process, is now you go straight to signature because we have a meeting of the minds. You want 3 years, I want one. Three is fine with us, approve and send. And now we're in e-sign land, now we're in DocuSign land, whatever it may be. So how we accelerate the common negotiations is really, really important. And then we've talked about it, but you need to show up in the right way, integrating with tools like Salesforce, like HubSpot, even your own repositories, even integrating with CLM. Like you could do this with other tools that you have internally that is not a CLM, but you may also have a CLM. At SimpleDocs, we have lots of customers that have a big bulky CLM and they can't possibly, for whatever reason, automate the NDA process. So we end up integrating in the back so that the completed NDAs run through the CLM. The last thing, and I'm going to end here, is 10 questions to ask. So you have implemented, so even if you've already implemented an automation program for your non-disclosure agreements, these are the questions you want to ask yourself. Let me run through these and then I'll pass this back to Shai. Are all routine contracts running through our system's workflow? You want to make sure you know where every NDA is in your organization. Is legal oversight required for routine contracts to get sent out? You need the answer to be no. There should be no oversight required for NDAs to go out. Are all signed contracts ending up back in a central repository? You need that answer to be yes. Can business teams access, generate routine contracts from their business tools, integrate Salesforce, CRM, whatever it may be? Do we have a streamlined process to manage negotiation requests to routine contracts? I'm talking, really emphasizing this point. Are we always signing with our e-sign tool? I know you're not always going to, but you want to preempt this. You want to move ahead. You're more likely to avoid red lines if it's very easy to get to signature for both sides. I'll say that again. You're likely to reduce red lines if it's easier for both sides to get to signature. Sending across a Word document that is otherwise blank as it relates to the counterparty information is more likely to elicit red lines than sending something over that is productized and is automated. Are we getting repeat requests from sales for help generating routine contracts? Is it not working? You need to, when we exist, when SimpleDocs and AutoNDA exist within a product, we normally don't hear from the customer, we don't hear from the counterparty, we don't hear from anyone. We just see the numbers going up. That's when we know we're doing our job because we're sitting in between the business and legal. What percentage of routine contracts are signed on our own paper? We want to increase that percentage. So instead of it being 50% or 60%, we want it to be closer to 70%. And you initiating the process faster will increase the percentage of the time that it lands on your paper. Are new employees easily adopting the process? You are a growing business. If you're signing lots of NDAs, you are a growing business. Good for you. Congratulations. It means that your sales team is growing every single day. And it also means that this cannot be an ongoing training initiative. It needs to be very easy and intuitive. Okay, I'm going to stop there. What Electra and I talked about, Shai, I'll take 30 seconds, is building systems. We didn't use the word system today, but that's what this is. An automation and a standard is a system that enables you to get back to work, enables you to do something more strategic. My favorite and one of Electra's favorite books is Thinking in Systems. If you would like a copy of it, it will help you think more deeply about what we are talking about today. And it's an incredible book if you haven't read it, Donella Meadows. So if you'd like a copy, you can email me at preston@simpledocs.com. And if you'd like to see what it looks like to automate a non-disclosure agreement, you can also send me a note and we'll give you a discount on doing it. Shai, that's it. I'm going to give it back to you. How did we do?
All right. Great job, guys. So a number of questions in the chat. And I think, so one of the issues I saw come up in the chat a lot, and thanks everybody for participating in the chat. If you have more questions, put them in the chat now. And if you enjoyed the program, please let Preston and Electra know. So generally, people are curious, how do you handle clauses that need to be negotiated? You know, what's the flow look like when you're using a standard NDA?
Well, I mean, there's two things here. You're either using a standard form that's non-negotiable because there's a hard standard. It's a hard standard. Or if you really do want to negotiate your NDAs, then you could use your own paper and use tools like SimpleDocs to do that. So Preston, I'll hand that over to you.
Yeah. So the answer is that a standard like oneNDA is rigid in nature. So you can add variables, but it's otherwise not negotiated. And the ideological reason for doing that is that everyone knows exactly what they're receiving. That in cases of private markets, for example, private equity has to negotiate. They're going to negotiate every single time. And they're going to redline every single time. And so in that case, the oneNDA standard is not the best. And so if you are in a scenario where the majority of your negotiations are outside of the variables that Electra went through, then we should use yours. But you can still automate it and you can still do all the other things that we talked about. So you can still do this. You can still do in-app negotiations. You can still have a really well-articulated representation of how balanced the NDA is. So all of these things are still possible using your own. But the beauty of oneNDA is everyone knows exactly what is inside it and that is sort of an immovable object.
Got it. How do you feel about NDA playbooks and clause banks? Is that part of, you know, oneNDA? Is that part of NDA automation?
Yeah, big time. So as soon as you enter into an environment where it's either third-party paper all the time or a significant amount of time, or you just, yours in the case of investment banking, and sorry to keep using that example, I'm spending a lot of time there right now. Investment bankers send out 300 NDAs, 200 of them are going to come back with extensive red lines. And now what? Right? Someone needs to accelerate that. And I'm a huge proponent, and I'm going to post a LinkedIn video on this tomorrow, Shai, is that I think that it is the end of NDA outsourcing and that we're finally here because I think we've done it forever and it's been necessary forever, but I think it's about to end because of AI. And so SimpleDocs has this product. There's lots of others, just literally hundreds of ways to do this. But the idea is that when either the third party paper comes in or when it's your own paper that's being redlined, there needs to be a streamlined way to risk rate, have your own checklist applied. Do we accept this jurisdiction? It's been selected. Great. Accept, move on. There has to be a more streamlined way, and there has to be a better way than outsourcing it entirely, because outsourcing feels clean and neat, except that you want to control the process because the only reason you're sending the NDA out is so you can get to the next step. So the process of outsourcing in and of itself is delaying your process. So Shai, I think that AI is coming for NDA outsourcing, but most importantly and aptly for our conversation today, I do think that it is the solution for the X percent of time that red lines are coming back and the X percent of time that counterparty, third-party NDAs are landing on our desk.
Yeah. Do you have any guidance on ways to capture all the data in a more automated way from the NDAs?
Which data? The change or just the whole, like all of the metadata of the agreement?
I guess just generally all the metadata of the
well, agreement. So if it's your paper, then it should all be captured. It should all be tagged and pre-captured so that if it runs through your system, if it's starting from you and it comes back through you, all of that should be captured and searchable. And then as it relates to third-party paper, you know, obviously history tracking needs to come in through a word add-in. This is where it gets a little, there's more pieces now, but you can manage redline history. And that is a way of capturing metadata. But when it's your paper running through a system like SimpleDocs or auto-NDA or one that you have, all of that metadata should be default captured in your repository.
Last question. Can you talk about NDA KPIs? There's a little bit of a discussion in the chat about NDA KPIs, and then we'll wrap up for the day and for the week.
Time to signature.
Yeah.
Percentage negotiated. What else, Electra?
I'd say how much of it is your paper or third party?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah,
we have our new dashboards coming out in the auto NDA product, and those are literally the KPIs. I think that there are probably others in the margin, but speed, like what we want to say is that we're going to reduce the percentage of red lines by 50%, and we're going to accelerate your time to signature by 90%. Those are our aspirational metrics, and those are the ones we're looking for in our dashboard. And so whatever tool you use, I would recommend looking at the same.
And Andy added a good one, deviations from acceptable terms.
Yes.
Or acceptable standards. That's a great one.
Yes. Yep. Yep. Right. And then, of course, in the metadata, being able to track that. And so not only seeing that from a KPI perspective, but of course, being able to quickly search and uncover that so you can see, show me all the ones that deviated from our jurisdiction, whatever it may be.
All right. Preston and Electra, I'll kick it back to you for closing remarks, and then we'll wrap up.
Electra, yeah. Closing remarks.
Thank you, everyone. I love the engagement in this chat. I just can't wait to read all the comments. It's really, really great to see such engagement. Thank you. Thanks for having me. It's been great.
Yeah, thank you, Shai. Long time coming. Shai and I met in New York in person for the first time very recently, but we've been chatting together for a very long time over Zoom and other. And so this is wonderful. I'm sure, Shai, there's a survey going out, but I hope this was the exact presentation you were expecting. Maybe not the information, maybe we said some provocative things, but I hope you were here to learn about standardization and automation, and I hope we delivered on that. My information is here, Preston@SimpleDocs.com. If you want to try AutoNDA for free, again, listen, this is like Electra and I have good businesses. We have customers. We are here representing our brands. We don't need to sell you anything, but we'd love to teach you about what we're doing. So if you're interested in trying anything, you should absolutely go, even if you hate oneNDA and the idea of oneNDA, you should go download it and really understand, sort of magnify that hate, or maybe not. Maybe you should go give it a try, but I totally encourage you to do that. And then similarly, if you want to give AutoNDA a try, send me a note and we'll get you set up. Shai, those are my last words. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Preston and Electra. Wonderful program. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in, for the engagement in the chat. It was wonderful.